Tonight, the Chamber of Commerce disturbed by news that a recent drug bust has been linked to a local business. The U.S. ambassador to the Eastern Caribbean defends a government's decision to deport undocumented immigrants. Lucy Legg dispels rumors that sabotage was responsible for power fluctuation in the north on Thursday. And Castries Southeast MP says Tuesday's walkout by opposition parliamentarians was staged. Very good evening to you. Welcome to the Friday edition of the DBS News World. My name is Timothy Polion. Our top story. The St. Lucia Chamber of Commerce, Industry and Agriculture is disturbed by news that a local business has been linked to a recent drug bust. The joint operation by police and customs officers resulted in the recovery of 40 rectangular blocks of cannabis in a container on the Castries docks and reportedly consigned to a locally registered commercial enterprise. DBS's Don Nicholas begins our news coverage.
The St. Lucia Chamber of Commerce has condemned unscrupulous activity among business people and has given the assurance that it is doing all in its power to ensure that this does not happen among its members. The chamber made the remarks against the backdrop of a drug bust involving a particular company.
St. Lucia Chamber of Commerce does not condone any business person, member or otherwise, engaging in illegal activity. We strongly support our members following the rule of law and acting as good corporate citizens. We think, in the most part, our members are all scrupulous and good corporate citizens and conduct themselves above board in all aspects of their business.
The chamber called on the government to do whatever is necessary to stamp out such activity in the business community.
We do understand that there are business persons and there are people engaged in business who may not act in keeping with the law, and we believe that the government must do what it has to do, and law enforcement must do what it has to do, protect our society, protect our borders, and bring to justice those who breach the law.
The chamber is hoping that such offenses can be minimized. For the DBS News World, I am Don Nicholas.
U.S. Ambassador to Barbados and the Eastern Caribbean, Linda Taliaferro, has defended her country's deportation policy. United States President Donald J. Trump recently expanded the nation's immigration rules, requiring expanded deportation of undocumented Caribbean and other immigrants. Sheffield Gillard reports.
The ambassador says she realized that deportation will be a problem for many countries, more specifically to small island states.
Deportation issue is not new. The United States, as with any country, has the authority to deport individuals who have committed and been convicted of crime. And the people we are deporting back to countries are individuals who have come to the United States and committed crimes for which they have paid their price, they have paid their dues, but because they're not United States citizens, under international treaty, we are allowed to send them back. So we are deporting them back to their homeland.
According to the ambassador, there are no systems in place for reintegration of deportees, but she noted that the U.S. is in dialogue with the various Caribbean islands to address that situation.
We want to figure out how best we can assist in developing those support systems for those individuals. But just as St. Lucia has the right and authority to deport someone who has committed a crime here in their country back to their homeland, so does every other nation in the world.
The new immigration policies can have severe implications for the region. For the DBS News World, I am Sheffield Gillard.
In other news, the St. Lucia Electricity Services Limited, Lucilec, says Thursday evening's power fluctuations in the north of the island were caused by a faulty line. This contradicts early suspicions that they may have been the result of sabotage by disgruntled company employees. The company and the employee's bargaining agent have been at loggerheads over wages. We hear more in this report.
Lucilec officials say Thursday night's power surge was caused by a faulty line at Ray Dwi, which affected surrounding communities. The electric company says technicians are working to ensure there is no recurrence.
We actually had loss of power in certain areas up north. It happened because our Ray Dwi line tripped. As a result, we had, it was a temporary fault on the Ray Dwi line. And as a result, we had loss of power at Rodney Bay, Bontier, Cap Estate, the Marina, and Grosely. Areas around that main area would have felt maybe just seen a flicker or a surge or anything like that. And that would happen because the network is interconnected. The system is one big ring. So if something happens, like a major fault like that, other areas would be affected, but it would not result in loss of power like it had in the main area, which is where the fault actually occurred.
There have been reports of possible sabotage by Grade 1 Lucilec workers who are currently unhappy with salary negotiations with the company. However, the company gave the assurance that Thursday night's power surge had nothing to do with that. This as the officials explained the issues relating to the strike action. The company says the wage matter is now before a tribunal.
There are five issues in dispute. The implementation of a grade structure for the line staff that is in keeping with what has been implemented for the rest of the staff, meaning the senior staff of the company. Compensation for the live line work, that is the guys you see up on the line when you're actually able to do the work with the actual while the lines are charged, so as in live line, and a change in the company's merit pay policy and appraisal system and the retirement age. Now, both parties, as in the CSA and the company, have come to agreement on the compensation for live line work, so that matter is now off the table. We had different interpretations of the retirement age, but have agreed to allow that matter to be settled by the tribunal.
Meanwhile, Lucilec's Soufre branch remains closed while others are partially opened. For the DBS News World, I am Don Nicholas.
We continue the broadcast with news that St. Jude Hospital is the recipient of an ambulance from Caribbean North Charities Foundation, a donor organization based in Toronto, Canada. The ambulance was officially handed over to the management of the St. Jude Hospital during a ceremony at the George Odlam Stadium.
The decommissioned 2011 Ford E350 ambulance was presented to the Caribbean North Charities Foundation by the York Regional Municipality Council in Ontario. It comes with a new portable HeartStart AED Philips defibrillator and a used Furno stretcher, fastener, and stretcher bar with installed tracks. St. Jude Hospital had been actively sourcing new ambulances to support the quality of healthcare delivery to the south of the island. Chairman Dr. Ulrich Mondesi expressed the hospital's profound appreciation for the donation.
You can give without loving, but you can never love without giving. For every life saved by this ambulance, showers of blessings will fall upon the members of its charitable service foundation, and that will give them even the greater capacity, the greater reasons to help not just us, but others in medical need.
St. Jude Hospital began its partnership with Caribbean North Charities Foundation 2 years ago, following an introduction by the Consulate General of St. Lucia in Toronto. Since then, the foundation has provided nursing education to over 40 St. Jude Hospital nurses, continuing medical education courses to medical staff, donated over 50 computers to the institution, and provided more than 1,400 backpacks to be distributed to the community. In her address to the ceremony, the deputy chairperson of Caribbean North Charities Foundation, Mrs. Pamela Harrock, affirmed her organization's commitment to continue assisting St. Jude Hospital.
The ambulance being presented here today was determined at our inaugural needs assessment at St. Jude's Hospital. We entered the memorandum of understanding with St. Jude's, of which we have fulfilled our commitment. We have today delivered, with the assistance of our deputy mayor and regional council, thank you, sir, in Canada, and Chief Barrett, who is the chief of EMS services in York Region, and he's here with us providing training and support to the paramedics and other personnel involved.
The handover ceremony was also attended by Minister of Health Mary Isaac.
So many people have such an appreciation for St. Jude, and we are seeing this here today, even from our friends far and abroad who come here. They really show their appreciation for this institution.
Deputy Mayor and Regional Councillor of the Town of Richmond Hill in Ontario, Mr. Vito Spatafora, representatives of the Caribbean North Charities Foundation, members of the St. Jude Hospital Board of Directors, as well as the hospital's management and staff were all present at the ceremony. This ambulance comes on the heels of a grant provided to St. Jude Hospital by the Government of Japan in February for the purchase of a new ACLS ambulance. For the DBS News World, I'm Chayla Mendez reporting.
Still in the first segment of the broadcast, Street Vibes.
Hi, I'm Alex Buske, and you're watching Friday Funnies on Street Vibes. Why was the alcoholic walking around with a ladder?
Why was the alcoholic walking around with a ladder? Because you want to get a high. Alcoholic walking around with a ladder. That's what you can believe, man. Myself, man. Well, he looking for more steps because he needs steps because he drunk, he can't get steps. So he walking the ladder to get steps.
Brian Alphonse, this one is for you. Why was the alcoholic walking around with a ladder? Because you heard the boss said that the drinks was on the house. You've just been watching Friday Funnies with me, Alex Buske, down here at the Aquarius Crossing, the intersection of Coral and St. Louis Streets. With that, we'll take you right back to our studio.
Thank you very much, Alex. You're watching St. Lucia's television and news leader and listening to us on Rhythm FM 95.5 and Hits 92.1 FM. We are also online on the big screen at the Aquarius Crossing in downtown Castries. When we come back, World Health Organization Day activities focus on depression and the public told to stay hydrated as temperatures continue to rise. Welcome back to the broadcast. Local health officials joined global counterparts today to raise awareness of depression. Depression is the focus of this year's observance of World Health Day. The theme, Depression Let's Talk, recognizes that depression is a treatable condition and seeks to address the fact that despite this, about 50% of cases of major depression still go untreated. Sheffield Gillard has more.
The theme for this year's observance is Depression, Let's Talk. Health and Wellness Minister Senator Mary Isaac says depression is quite rampant in St. Lucian society and blames it for the number of suicides over the years. Ms. Isaac highlighted the minister's effort to sensitize members of the public on the condition and its treatment.
There's a lot of stigma attached to depression as well because people associate it with mental disorders, but with mental illness, but people have to encourage people whom they think are depressed to come out and get help and support because there is help and support from the Ministry of Health.
As to the effectiveness of these support systems, she said,
a person may go into a deep depression and when they come for help, the remedies that they ask them to follow, they will start. And as soon as they feel a little better, they stop. They do not continue to come for the assistance that they should really continue to get from the healthcare sector. So that poses a problem.
According to the World Health Organization, the risk of becoming depressed is increased by poverty, unemployment, death of loved ones, relationship breakups, physical illness and problems caused by alcohol and drug abuse.
Depression is very important. It's a very real problem, and not only in St. Lucia and Latin America, but worldwide. It's a very significant problem. It causes difficulties in productivity most times because it happens a lot during the productive age. So it leads to serious problems with functioning in people, functioning at home, at work, among their families.
Activities to celebrate the day include a health lecture and exhibition at the National Mental Wellness Center. For the DBS News World, I am Sheffield Gillard.
The St. Lucia Med Service is urging the public to take precautions to protect themselves from unusually high temperatures. That means taking special care to avoid sunburns and to drink a lot of water even when not thirsty. Don Nicholas reports.
The Met Office has confirmed the existence of a dry spell where the temperature can be unusually hot. The office has predicted that the spell will continue at least throughout the weekend. To this end, the office is calling on the public to take the necessary precautions to avoid being adversely affected by the weather. For example, officials highlighted the need to keep hydrated and also recommended the use of sunscreen.
What they could do, some people, if they're out in the sun, use certain creams, you know, so that they don't get sunburns. Drink a lot of water, you know, to remain hydrated. Try not to stay in the sun for lengthy periods of time.
The office is also calling on the public to be mindful of skin diseases that can be caused by the extreme temperature and exposure to direct sunlight.
It's just that like I said, we're in the dry season, the sun is hot, and we don't expect rainfall from now until the weekend. The whole weekend we expect it to remain dry, so people have to take precaution.
The Met Office is hoping that the public will heed the advice. For the DBS News World, I am Don Nicholas.
And now this. St. Lucia is hosting a regional workshop geared towards developing the coconut industry. The workshop, which took place at the Palm Haven Hotel, identified the challenges confronting the sector and devised strategies to meet them. Don Nicholas has the details.
Issues such as Pradya Lasni, use of technology, and marketing came to the fore. Pradya Lasni, the practice where thieves steal produce from plantations, has taken a toll on the industry in recent times, and authorities are seeking ways to clamp down on this problem. The need to improve on marketing strategies was highlighted, as well as the greater use of technology to promote business.
And so when you heard about larceny, pests and diseases and so on, the presenter was basically saying what were the major issues that plagued the industry. And later on, the plan is for them to begin to say how the group gets involved in addressing those issues.
The workshop brought together stakeholders in the coconut industry from across the region. Participants sought to exchange information and ideas on the way forward in order to boost the industry.
People didn't pay much attention to issues like density, maintenance, selection of varieties, and improved planting material. And so in the long term, this has been affecting productivity. What this project is going to do is forge stakeholders in the coconut industries to go and look at those challenges.
The workshop was held at the Palm Haven Hotel. For the DBS News World, I am Don Nicholas.
The mayor of Castries says the concerns of bus drivers operating near his office have not gone unheard. The drivers have repeatedly complained about the filthy, stagnant, mosquito-ridden water in the drain near their bus stop. The mayor visited the site personally this week to assess the situation. Alex Bosque has that story.
The bus operator complained about the stench emanating from the stagnant water in a clogged drain near the Hospital Road and Mon bus stand. There are concerns about the health implications for operators and commuters. The Castries mayor, on hearing of the concerns, came out to assess the problem personally.
I would like to congratulate your program, Street Vibes, because last night when I was in the comfort of my home, I saw that the guy was, highlighting that problem. It's not that he was complaining, highlighting, and I like that. I mean, as a concerned citizen and somebody who plied the route here, he raised that issue, and I'm very happy that he did it. I've come today to look at it, and there's a serious problem. So we're going to attend to that immediately. I mean, we have somebody, you see, when you leave your office and you see things, one guy said, look, to cut and slab, and I think that is an excellent idea so that we'll be able to continuously be able to clean it in one instance is that. So we're going to do that, and we're going to do that as quickly as possible.
Thank you.
But once again, thank you for the program and keep going on, because these are things you want to highlight. When this problem comes up, let us know, because while I may be walking and driving, I will not see all the problems.
Just a few weeks ago, a bus operator, among other people, complained about the falling chunks of concrete off the CDC apartments as they walked by. This, they say, is extremely dangerous, and they're calling for something to be done about the situation as quickly as possible.
It's a good thing you mentioned that. After budget, hopefully that CCC will be taking over the running of the CDCs. I know, as you know, I'm a CDC man, so I know there is some work that has to be done. And I will ensure that is done. The government has a wider plan for these CDCs, which I cannot divulge right now. But definitely the government has a plan for these CDCs. Or should I say, not the CDCs, but the residents of these CDCs.
The mayor of Castries says he appreciates citizens highlighting the things that affect them. For the DBS News World, I am Alex Bousquet.
When the broadcast continues in just a moment, Guy Joseph accuses the opposition of staging Tuesday's walkout. Welcome back to the DBS News World. Castries Southeast MP Guy Joseph says Tuesday's walkout by opposition parliamentarians was staged. Joseph believes that the opposition was trying to avoid dealing with one of the agenda items down for discussion that day, and which seeks to give the state greater authority to prosecute corrupt public officials.
The opposition members of parliament opted to walk out of the house during last Tuesday's sitting. They were unhappy with the decision to exclude a motion from the order paper. The motion sought to request a debate on the amendments to the Citizenship by Investment Program, with which the opposition had taken issue from the outset. Castries Southeast MP Guy Joseph, speaking as a guest on Talk with Rick Wayne, said the walkout was staged, since the opposition would have already received word from the speaker that the negative resolution was based on assumptions and not facts, and as a result, needed to be revisited.
A resolution must be based on facts, and there were things that were questionable with nothing to back it up. So all we were saying is that this needs to be reviewed and written better and presented.
The Castries Southeast MP says he is ready to debate the negative resolution. He believes that the Labour Party could not face the Crown Proceedings resolution, which would seek to remove the statute of limitations for holding corrupt officials accountable for their actions.
What they stated in their findings is that if the statutes of limitations were not there, that the government could have taken certain steps to recover the losses that it sustained. So it was clearly a situation where, because you are dealing with government, and like I said, if a government stays in office for 20 years and did something in year one, the statutes of limitation would run out before this government demits office.
Just last Thursday, Independent Senator Mauricio Thomas Francis called for a greater level of maturity to be displayed among members when disagreements arise. She said there are many ways to work around the situation instead of walking out. For the DBS News World, I am Don Nicholas.
The HIV-TB Elimination Project at the Organization of Eastern Caribbean States Commission held a two-day workshop with regional stakeholders in St. Lucia last week to develop an evidence-based approach to HIV treatment in the OECS through the implementation of surveys. Over the past decade, increased access to and use of antiretroviral treatment, ART, has led to remarkable reductions in HIV-related morbidity, mortality, and incidence worldwide. With the increase of ART, however, the emergence of HIV drug resistance has become a concern in many regions. HIV drug resistance, HIVDR, can be acquired among patients receiving ART due to treatment interruptions, poor adherence, or suboptimal drug combinations. HIVDR can hinder long-term therapeutic success at the individual level and increase the risk for onward transmission of a drug-resistant virus. Ms. Lynnard Hardy, Monitoring and Evaluation Officer for the HIV-TB Elimination Project at the OECS Commission, said that the generation of data on HIV-DR is crucial for the subregion to make informed decisions on effective HIV treatment. Several young people successfully completed a hospitality training course administered by Sandals Resorts. The participants were presented with their certificates at a graduation ceremony today. The aim of the program is to provide requisite skills to young participants who have an interest in becoming hospitality professionals. Alex Buske has details.
Sandals has recognized the importance of ensuring that the human resource pool in St. Lucia can support the growing tourism industry. The resort is happy to be associated with the hospitality training program.
The program started in St. Lucia in 2009, and thus far it exists in all seven countries that Sandals operates. So it is something very dear and very important to the company. Many of the persons who have been certified for the program have actually gained employment, not just at Sandals, but at many other resorts and institutions within the sector.
The training program is viewed as a very important tool in terms of developing human resource in the country. Interested students apply and are granted entry to the program on successful completion of an interview.
Then the students are placed within the various departments that they have selected of their interest, and the training begins. It comprises of both soft skills training and technical skills training, and it is strategically organized so that we ensure that whatever is transferred in terms of knowledge and skills is done in a most meaningful way to the students.
The training for me was a very excited part of my life. I enjoyed it very much, especially my managers and training managers, especially Mr. Andre. It was great training with them at Sandals. And the team, not forgetting the team, they're lovely.
What are you looking forward to now that you're graduating?
Well, I'm looking forward to furthering myself with the tourism industry and going back at Sandals Regency, Hello Talk, working.
It was great. I can see my experience at Sandals working at the front desk. It was a great experience. At the beginning, I was a very shy and timid person. However, working in the hotel industry made my communication skills a lot better. And I did have a fun time at Sandals Grand.
Okay, what do you take it from here after graduation?
I am hoping that I get called back and then I can continue at the front desk.
My experience, it was definitely indeed an eye-opening experience for me. I learned so much, more than I even thought that I would even be capable of doing for myself. So when I came in there, I had a whole different perception. I wasn't as open as I was before going into the front desk. And it was really a good experience for me to just be out there, mingle with people, interact, and, you know, be the best that I could be.
For the DBS News World, I am Alex Busquet.
When we come back in just a moment, the Prime Minister's office concerned about the number of fake social media accounts carrying his name. You're watching the DBS News World. Thank you so much for staying with us. The Office of the Prime Minister has noted an increase in the number of fake social media profiles bearing the name of the Prime Minister or purporting to be the Office of the Prime Minister. This, according to the Senior Communications Officer at the Office of the Prime Minister, is cause for concern.
We want people to know that they're communicating directly with the Prime Minister or the Office of the Prime Minister when they send messages. So we basically issued a communique to the public to let them know what are the official pages of the Prime Minister on social media. Where we have noticed the fake accounts mostly has been on Facebook. unfortunately. So basically, people have been starting accounts in the name of the Prime Minister and then communicating with people as if they are the Prime Minister. And this obviously causes us some concern because people do think their messages are getting across when in fact it's not.
Ms. McDonald says there are official pages which the Office of the Prime Minister has established.
I can go through some of the pages that are official pages of the Prime Minister and the Office of the Prime Minister. First of all, we have the Facebook profile, which is facebook.com/AlanM Shastney. Then we have the Twitter, which is twitter.com/OPM St. Lucia, which is S-A-I-N-T-L-U-C-I-A. We also have the YouTube page where we post a lot of the videos, interviews that the Prime Minister has done for the week. So people can go on there and basically review what has happened in the Office of the Prime Minister for the week. We also put our regular cabinet morning briefings on there as well. And the account for that is youtube.com/C/St. Lucia Prime Minister. I'll also give you the Instagram, which is Instagram/OPM St. Lucia, also spelled S-A-I-N-T-L-U-C-I-A.
Ms. McDonald is advising the public to use only the official platforms. The XS Productions team is set to host its 19th annual Kite Flying Festival on Easter Monday, April 17, 2017, at Pigeon Island, which is left of the Landings Resort. The event is being called Kites in Full Extreme and is a family-oriented event started back in 1998 to encourage the tradition of kite flying and kite making, which was in decline. Registration will commence from 10:30 a.m. on the day of the competition for four classes of competitors: juniors, adults, groups, and flying aces. There are six categories to be judged this year. Biggest flying kite, also highest, smallest, most colorful, also most patriotic kite, most creative and innovative kite. Ready-made kites are not being considered for judging this year. Homemade kites will be judged for their flying capabilities, workmanship, and use of color. Juniors and adults should bring their best game, as this year it is winner takes all. The competition among the flying aces heats up as they are set to scale new heights of artistry and technique. The XS Productions annual Easter Kite Flying Festival is the longest running family outdoor event on the island, and the XS Production team encourages parents and children to get creative with the kites and participate in the festival. When we come back in just a moment, the Lutheran Church undertakes a major exercise. Welcome back. A new church group is seeking to empower the island's women on the journey of self-discovery. We learn how in this report.
The organization Self-Help is seeking to not only create greater awareness of the issues facing women, but to help those women find solutions.
Majority of us in St. Lucia, we came from a background where we were not brought up properly, you know, and not brought up properly, and then coming into a relationship to deal with this kind of thing, sometimes we felt that we were doing the right, and then we couldn't handle it. So when I came to the self-help, it teach me how to value myself as a woman, as a mother, and as a wife to help my family.
Mrs. Henry says that the self-help group is an important group for women, especially those with low self-esteem, as the group can empower them.
When you attend a self-help meeting and you gain, it's like a food, like something that you're missing, that something that will help you with all the areas of your life, like your spiritual life, your physical life, your everything. It's like a multidisciplinary, you know, to change behaviors, to, you know, to show, you know, that you're different, that no matter what happened, no matter what the situation is, that you are going to be you, you know, in a respectable manner.
The group is located at the Universal Church at the corner of High Street and Shusi Road, and will be holding a meeting on Saturday, April 8th at the church at 3 p.m. For the DBS News World, Melissa Paul reporting.
In other news, on Saturday, April 8th, the Trinity Lutheran Church in Bize will be hosting a community cleanup day. Starting at 9 o'clock in the morning, Trinity is inviting all interested parties, including members of Trinity Lutheran Church and the community of Bize, to pitch in and do a little Easter cleaning. According to Pastor Tom Spiegelberg, the church believes it has a responsibility to take care of the community around it. Not doing so, he says, would be disrespectful to God. We criticize those who randomly throw trash around our neighborhoods. But if we pass by without doing anything, we are just as much to blame, he says. The theme of the cleanup this year is Love Where You Live. We'll be back in just a moment. Just in time for the usual reminder. The Chamber of Commerce disturbed by news that a recent drug bust has been linked to a local business. The U.S. ambassador to the Eastern Caribbean defends a government's decision to deport undocumented immigrants. Lucy Legg dispels rumors that sabotage was responsible for power fluctuation in the north on Thursday. And Castries Southeast MP says Tuesday's walkout by opposition parliamentarians was staged. And that's the broadcast. Thank you so much for watching and listening. On behalf of the entire news team, I'm Timothy Polion, wishing you a very good evening and a pleasant weekend. Good night, and see you next time.